Thank you for watching Dark Dreamer. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe to the channel. Please enjoy the story, Caged Girl.
My name is James, and I run a small phone repair shop in a quiet neighborhood. It's a modest business, but it keeps me busy and pays the bills. Most days are uneventful, filled with routine repairs and occasional chats with regular customers. But one day, a seemingly ordinary repair job turned my life into a nightmare. It was a rainy afternoon when a middle-aged man hurried into my shop, clutching a broken phone. He was agitated, his eyes darting around nervously as he handed me the device. "Please, can you fix this?" he asked, his voice trembling. "It's very important." I assured him I would do my best and took the phone to the back of the shop. The screen was shattered and the casing was badly damaged, but it was nothing I couldn't handle. I set to work, carefully prying open the phone and assessing the damage. As I removed the broken components and began installing new ones, I noticed something odd. The phone's memory card was still intact, and out of curiosity, I decided to check its contents. It wasn't uncommon for customers to have important data they wanted to save, and I figured I could back it up for him. When I inserted the memory card into my computer, a series of files appeared. Photos, documents, and videos. One video file in particular caught my attention. It was labeled simply watchme.mp4. A sense of unease washed over me as I clicked on the file. The video started with a shaky camera shot of a dark room. The only light came from a single, dim bulb hanging from the ceiling. As the camera panned around, I saw a small metal cage in the center of the room. Inside the cage was a young girl, no older than 16, huddled in a corner, her eyes wide with fear. My heart raced as I watched the video. The girl looked terrified, her clothes tattered and dirty. She glanced around the room, her eyes pleading for help. A voice off camera spoke, deep and menacing. "You know what you have to do," it said. "If you want to get out of here, you have to follow the rules." The girl nodded, tears streaming down her face. The video cut off abruptly, leaving me in a state of shock. Who was this girl? Why was she trapped in a cage? And who was the voice behind the camera? I couldn't shake the image from my mind. My hands trembled as I continued to work on the phone, my thoughts consumed by the disturbing video. When the repair was finished, I reluctantly returned the phone to its owner. He seemed relieved, but didn't stay to chat. As he left, I couldn't help but feel a sense of foreboding. That night, I couldn't sleep. The girl's face haunted me, her silent plea for help echoing in my mind. I knew I had to do something, but I didn't know where to start. The video had given me no clues about the girl's location or identity. The next day, I decided to take a risk. I called a friend of mine, Detective Sarah Williams, who worked in the local police department. Sarah and I had known each other since childhood, and I trusted her implicitly. I told her about the video and my concerns. Sarah listened carefully, her voice calm and reassuring. "Bring me the memory card," she said. "I'll see what I can find out." I handed it over, hoping she could uncover something that would lead us to the girl. Over the next few days, Sarah worked tirelessly to trace the origins of the video. She called me regularly with updates, but progress was slow. The video had been encrypted, and it took time to break through the layers of security. Meanwhile, I tried to carry on with my daily routine, but the sense of dread never left me. One evening, Sarah called with a breakthrough. "James, we've identified the girl," she said. "Her name is Emily Parker. She went missing 6 months ago, and her case has been cold ever since." The news hit me like a punch to the gut. Emily Parker had been the subject of a high-profile missing persons case. Her disappearance had devastated her family and shocked the community. And now it seemed she was alive, but in grave danger. Sarah continued, "We also managed to trace the video to an IP address. It leads to an abandoned warehouse on the outskirts of town. We're organizing a raid, but we need to be cautious. Whoever is behind this is dangerous." I offered to help, but Sarah insisted I stay out of it. This is police business, James. You've done enough by bringing this to our attention. Reluctantly, I agreed, but I couldn't shake the feeling of responsibility. I had found the video, and I felt connected to Emily's plight. The night of the raid, I paced my living room, anxiously waiting for news. Hours passed, and finally Sarah called. We found her, James. Emily is safe. Relief washed over me, but it was short-lived. But there's something else, Sarah said, her voice trembling. The warehouse was full of cages. Emily wasn't the only one. The revelation of multiple victims sent shockwaves through the community. The police discovered more videos, each one more horrifying than the last. The warehouse was a nightmare factory, a place where innocent lives were shattered and unspeakable acts were committed. Emily was in a state of shock, but managed to provide some information. She spoke of a man named Victor, the mastermind behind the operation. He was meticulous and cruel, taking pleasure in the suffering of his captives. Emily's testimony painted a picture of a sadistic predator who thrived on control and manipulation. The police launched a manhunt for Victor, but he had vanished without a trace. The warehouse provided few clues, and it seemed he had planned his escape meticulously. As the investigation dragged on, the media frenzy intensified, and fear gripped the town. Emily's recovery was slow. She was placed in a secure location, her family and the authorities doing everything they could to help her heal. Sarah kept me updated, and I visited Emily when she felt ready. Our conversations were strained, her trauma evident in every word. But she was strong, determined to reclaim her life. One evening, Emily confided in me. "Victor isn't done," she said, her voice barely a whisper. "He told me there are others, places like the warehouse. He's part of something bigger." The thought chilled me to the bone. If Victor was part of a larger network, how many more victims were out there? The police intensified their efforts, but leads were scarce. Victor had covered his tracks well, and the trail grew colder with each passing day. Months passed, and life slowly returned to a semblance of normalcy. But the shadow of Victor's crimes loomed large, and the search for him continued. One evening, as I was closing up the shop, my phone rang. It was an unknown number, but I answered anyway. "James," a voice whispered. It was Victor. My blood ran cold. "I know you're helping Emily. I know you gave the police the video. You've made things difficult for me, but I'm not finished." Fear and anger surged through me. "What do you want?" I demanded, trying to keep my voice steady. "To show you the consequences of meddling in things you don't understand," he replied. "Meet me at the old mill tonight. Come alone, or Emily suffers." The call ended, leaving me shaken. I knew it was a trap, but I couldn't risk Emily's safety. I called Sarah, explained the situation, and despite her protests, insisted on going alone. We devised a plan to have backup nearby, ready to intervene. As I approached the old mill, the night was eerily silent. The decaying structure loomed ahead, its shadow stretching like a monstrous claw. I steeled myself and entered, flashlight in hand. Victor was waiting. He stood in the center of the room, his face hidden in shadows. "Welcome, James," he said, his voice dripping with malice. "I'm glad you could make it." Before I could respond, I heard a faint cry. Emily was there, tied to a chair, her eyes wide with fear. Rage consumed me, and I lunged at Victor. But he was prepared, dodging easily and striking back. The struggle was intense, but I fought with everything I had. Just as Victor seemed to gain the upper hand, the sound of sirens filled the air. Sarah and her team burst in, guns drawn. Victor sneered, but didn't resist as they apprehended him. Emily was freed, and I collapsed in relief. The nightmare was over, but the scars remained. Victor's network was dismantled, and more victims were rescued, but the memories of his atrocities lingered. In the aftermath, Emily and I found solace in our shared experience. She began to heal, slowly but surely, and I returned to my life, forever changed by the horrors I had uncovered. The broken phone had led to a darkness I never imagined, but it also brought justice and a chance for redemption.